his deal. Two sets of longer selections from the letter of your servant, St. John Paul II, to the Church in America. Written just over 20 years ago, so many of the truths he spoke remain pertinent to us today. The first of these selections will call us to reflect upon how you are calling us as your church, as a community, deeper conversion, deeper faithfulness into our disciples and representatives in your kingdom. And the second will call us to reflect on how we can serve to be agents of hope in the midst of the challenges this world faces, to reflect the compassion. has come to the Father of all peoples, asking him to protect the freedom of the United States of America and the rights and liberty of all citizens of this great nation. For the Catholic Church, that we may always remain faithful to Francis, our Pope, our bishops, we pray to the Lord. For the nations of the world, that America will help them to achieve or maintain peace, freedom, justice, prosperity. We pray to the Lord. For our president, that he will be guided to act wisely for the common good. We pray to the Lord. For all those elected to serve us, that they will respect our liberties and defend the rights of the unborn, the aged, the poor, and racial minorities. We pray to the Lord. For the souls of all those who made this nation, that they will enjoy the reward of eternal life. We pray to the Lord. Father of all peoples, grant these prayers we make for our beloved nation, assisted by the intercession of the Immaculate Mother of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Reflect on the words of Psalm 127. Unless the Lord build the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guard the city, in vain does the guard keep watch. In vain is your earlier rising and putting off your rest at night, to eat bread earned by hard toil. All this God gives to his beloved. Certainly, children are a gift from the Lord, the fruit of the womb, a reward, like arrows in the hand of a warrior, are the sons born to one's youth. Blessed is the man who has filled his quiver with them. He will never be ashamed. Prayer to Jesus Christ for the families of America, written by St. John Paul II. We thank you, Lord Jesus, because the gospel of the Father's love, with which you came to save the world, has been proclaimed far and wide in America. It's a gift to the Holy Spirit that fills us with gladness. We thank you for the gift of your life, which you have given us, by loving us to the end. Your life makes us children of God, brothers and sisters to each other. Increase, O Lord, our faith, our love for you, present in all the tabernacles of the continent. Grant us to be faithful witnesses to your resurrection for the younger generation of Americans, so that in knowing you they may follow you and find in you their peace and joy. Only then will they know that they are brothers and sisters of all God's children scattered throughout the world. You, who in becoming man chose to belong to a human family, each family has the virtues which filled with light the family home of Nazareth. May families always be united as you and the Father are one. And may they be living witnesses to love, justice, and solidarity. Make them schools of respect, forgiveness, and mutual help, so that the world may believe. Help them to be the source of vocations to the priesthood and consecrated life, and all the other forms of firm Christian commitment. Protect your church and the successor of Peter, to whom you, Good Shepherd, have entrusted the task of feeding your flock. Grant that the church in America may flourish and grow richer in the fruits of holiness. Teach us to love your Mother Mary as you loved her. Give us strength to proclaim your word with courage in the work of the new evangelization, so that the world may know new hope. Our Lady of Guadalupe, Mother of America, pray for us. urging us to a greater ownership of our identity as your disciples. Rejoicing in the faith received and praising Christ for this immense gift, the Church in America is deeply aware of Christ's desire to meet the inhabitants, the so-called new world, so that gathering them into his church, he might be present in the continent's history. Now, no less than in the past, the words of the apostle echo in their hearts. If I preach the gospel, I have no reason to boast. It is my duty. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. This duty is founded on the risen Lord's command to the apostles before he ascended into heaven. Preach the gospel to all creation. This command applies to the whole church, and in this moment of her history, the church in America is called to take it up and respond with loving generosity to the fundamental task of evangelization. The gospels tell of Jesus encountering people in very diverse situations. At times, these are situations of sin, which show the need for conversion and the Lord's forgiveness. At other moments, we find people searching for the truth and genuinely trusting in Jesus. Positive attitudes which help to establish a friendship with him and awaken the desire to imitate him. Nor can we forget the gifts with which the Lord prepares some people for a later encounter. Thus, by making Mary full of grace from the very beginning, God prepared her for the realization in her, God's supreme encounter with human nature, the ineffable mystery of the Incarnation. Like the social virtues, sins do not exist in the abstract, but are the consequence of personal acts. Hence, it is necessary to bear in mind that America today is a complex reality, the result of the attitudes and actions of the men and women who live there. It is in this real and concrete situation that they must encounter Jesus. The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe the good news. These words with which Jesus began his Galilean ministry still echo in the ears of bishops, priests, deacons, consecrated men and women, and the lay faithful throughout America. Christ's call to conversion finds an echo in the words of the apostle. It is time now to wake from sleep, because our salvation is closer than when we first became believers. The encounter with the living Jesus compels us to conversion. Conversion leads to fraternal communion because it enables us to understand that Christ is the head of the church, his mystical body. It urges solidarity because it makes us aware that whatever we do for others, especially for the poorest, we do for Christ himself. Conversion, therefore, fosters a new life in which there is no separation between faith and works and our daily response to the universal call to holiness. Yet conversion is incomplete if we are not aware of the demands of the Christian life and if we do not strive to meet them. Unfortunately, at both the personal and communal level, there are great shortcomings in relation to a more profound conversion and with regard to relationships between sectors, institutions, and groups within the church. He who does not love his brother, whom he has seen, cannot love God, whom he has not seen. Fraternal charity means attending to all the needs of our neighbor. If anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? We read in the first letter of St. John. Hence, for the Christian people of America, conversion to the gospel means to revive. political field is clearly part of the vocation and activity of the lay faithful. In this regard, however, it is most important, especially in a pluralistic society, to understand correctly the relationship between the political community and the church, and to distinguish clearly between what individual believers or groups of believers undertake in their own name as citizens guided by Christian conscience, and what they do in the name of the church and communion with their pastors. The church, which in virtue of her office and competence, can in no way be confused with the political community, nor tied to any political system, is both a sign and safeguard of the transcendent character of the human person. In this life, conversion is a goal which is never fully attained. On the path which the disciple is called to follow in the footsteps of Jesus, conversion is a lifelong task. The change of mentality, metanoia, means striving to assimilate the values of the gospel, which contradict the dominant tendencies of the world. Hence, there is a need to renew constantly the living encounter with the living Jesus Christ, since this is the way which leads us to continue conversion. The proposal of the new lifestyle applies to all Christians living in America. They are asked to no more deeply to make their own a genuine spirituality, a genuine Christian spirituality. By spirituality, which is the goal of conversion, we mean not a part of life, but the whole of life guided by the Holy Spirit. Among the many elements of spirituality which all Christians must make their own, prayer holds a preeminent place. Prayer leads Christians little by little to acquire a contemplative view of reality, enabling them to recognize God in every moment and in everything, to contemplate God in every person, to seek His will in all that happens. Prayer, both personal and liturgical, is the duty of every Christian. Jesus Christ, the good news of the Father, warns can't say to you, if you did it to one of the least of these, my brother, you did it to me. The awareness of communion with Christ and with our brothers and sisters, for its part, the fruit of conversion, leads to the service of our neighbors in all their needs, material and spiritual, since the face of Christ shines forth in every human being. Solidarity is thus the fruit of the communion, which is grounded in the mystery of the triune God, and in the Son of God who took flesh and died for all. It is expressed in Christian love, which seeks the good of others, especially those most in need. Taking the gospel as a starting point, the culture of solidarity needs to be promoted, capable of inspiring timely initiatives in support of the poor and outcasts, especially refugees forced to leave their villages and lands in order to flee violence. At a time when, in the sphere of morality, there is a disturbing spread of relativism and subjectivism, the Church in America is called to proclaim with renewed vigor that conversion consists in commitment to the person of Jesus Christ, with all the theological and moral implications taught by the magisterium of the Church. If we believe that Jesus is the truth, we cannot fail to desire ardently to be his witnesses in order to bring our brothers and sisters closer to the full truth that dwells in the Son of God made man, who died and rose from the dead for the salvation of the human race. In this way, we will be able to be in this world living beacons of faith, hope, and charity. The Church's social doctrine also makes possible a clearer appreciation of the gravity of the social sins which cry to heaven because they generate violence, disrupt peace and harmony between communities within single nations, between nations, and between the different regions of the continent. Among these must be mentioned the drug trade, the recycling of illicit funds, corruption at every level, the terror of violence, the arms race, racial discrimination, inequality between social groups, and the irrational destruction of nature. These sins are a sign of a deep crisis caused by the loss of a sense of God and the absence of those moral principles which should guide the life of every person. In the absence of moral points of reference, an unbridled greed for wealth and power takes over, obscuring any gospel-based vision of social reality. Not infrequently, this leads some public institutions to ignore the actual social climate. Indeed, the poor are becoming ever more numerous, victims of specific policies and structures which are often unjust. On the basis of the gospel, the best response to this tragic situation is the promotion of solidarity and peace, with a view to achieving real justice. The rule of law is the necessary condition for the establishment of an authentic democracy. For democracy to develop, there is need for civic education and the promotion of public order and peace. In effect, there is no authentic and stable democracy without social justice. Thus, the Church needs to pay greater attention to the formation of consciences, which will prepare leaders of society for public life at all levels, promote civic education, respect for law, for human rights, inspire greater efforts in the ethical training of political leaders. It is appropriate to recall that the foundation on which all human rights rest is the dignity of the person. God's masterpiece, man, is made in divine image and likeness. Pilgrim Church in America prepares enthusiastically to meet the challenges of today's world and those that will come in the future. In the gospel, the good news of the resurrection of the Lord is accompanied by the invitation to fear not. The Church in America wishes to walk in hope with serene trust in the Lord of history, free from prejudice, hesitation, selfishness, fear, or doubt, and convinced of the fundamental and primary service which she must provide as a testimony to her fidelity to God and to the men and women of this continent. Furthermore, the Church in America feels especially impelled to walk in faith, responding with gratitude to the love of Jesus, the merciful love of God. Time we'll pray a litany for liberty. The opening prayer, Christ the Lord has called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. Let us turn to him humble with fervent petition, seeking the grace to root out from our hearts all trace of darkness and all that holds us back from walking in full freedom of the children of God. As Christ is our great model for that inner freedom, which enables us we too may follow him in the fullness of spiritual freedom. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
From this first set of petitions, please respond, free our hearts. Christ, victor over sin and death. Jesus, source of life and hope, free our hearts. Jesus, fullness of truth and mystery,
free our hearts.
Jesus, teacher of seeking hearts,
free our hearts.
Jesus, healer of body and soul,
free our hearts.
Jesus, bringer of mercy and justice,
free our hearts.
Jesus, who humble the heart and mind,
free our hearts.
Jesus, release of captives.
Free our hearts.
Jesus, voice against violence.
Free our hearts.
Jesus, courage for the lowly and downtrodden.
Free our hearts.
Jesus, origin of all authority and power.
Free our hearts.
Jesus, true lawgiver.
Free our hearts.
Jesus, unity of order and passion.
Free our hearts.
Jesus, freedom of the spirit. Jesus, obedient Son of the Father. To this next set of petitions, respond, give us your grace. For the freedom to love. For the freedom to believe. For the freedom to hope. For the freedom to worship. For the freedom to serve in charity. For the freedom to care for the suffering. For the freedom to comfort the sick. For the freedom to feed the hungry. For the freedom to shelter the homeless. For the freedom to proclaim the gospel. For the freedom to walk in chastity. For the freedom to live in peace. For the freedom to work in good conscience. For the freedom to seek justice. For the freedom to reject sin. For the freedom to reject coercion. For the freedom to reject falsehood. For the freedom to reject injustice. O God, who gave one origin to all people, willed to gather from them one family for himself, fill all hearts, we pray, with the fire of your love, and kindle in them the desire for the just advancement of their neighbor, that through the good things which you richly bestow upon all, each human person may be brought to perfection, every division may be removed, and equity and justice may be established in human society, especially in our nation. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
sacrament and let us in memorial of your passion, grant us, we pray, so to revere the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may always experience in ourselves the fruits of your redemption, who live and reign with God the Father in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
Divine praises together. Blessed be God. Blessed be His holy name. Blessed be Jesus Christ, true God and true King. Blessed be His name. Blessed be His most sacred heart. Blessed be His most precious blood. Blessed be Jesus, the most holy sacrament of the altar. Blessed be the Holy Spirit. Blessed be the great Mother of God, Mary, most holy. Blessed be her holy and immaculate. Blessed be her glorious assumption. Blessed be the name of Mary, Virgin and Mother. Blessed be St. Joseph, her most dear spouse. Blessed be God, our angels. May the heart of Jesus and the most blessed sacrament be praised, adored, and loved with grateful affection at every moment in all the tabernacles of the world, even unto the end of time. Fittingly, on the Feast of Our Lady of Sorrows, to pray for all victims of